there to this meeting, and thank you for coming. Just to make sure, this is the meeting on Turkish uprisings, make sure you're not in the wrong room. Now, the format of the talk is basically, we have the two speakers here, which I'm going to introduce in a minute, who are both going to talk, Andrew first and then followed by Sevinc. And then we'll, as is traditional, throw it open to a question and answer session from the floor. We want a create a supportive atmosphere, mutual support and mutual respect, where people can say things and have different opinions and so on and be listened to. But at the same time, we would like also people not to go on and on and on, because then you're stopping somebody else having their say as well. So if someone wants to make a contribution from the floor, but I feel like a benevolent dictator here, that you're going on a little while, I'll sort of make a signal to wrap up, and so on. But, I mean, you've seen all this before. So, without further ado, I'm actually going to introduce the two speakers, and they'll probably give you a little bit more about what they're going to talk on. First of all, it's Sevinc, who is from Turkey, but is now living in Ireland, and has lived in Ireland for many years, off and on, in fact, but was living back in Turkey up until
March.
She was also sort of in her previous life involved with the Turkish left, and has many unpleasant experiences with CS gas over the years and all the rest of it, but also a knowledge of the political context in Turkey, if you like. And I'm sure she's going to lay out a bit more about what she'll be talking on. But we're very lucky to have her. We're very lucky to have her here, if you like to put the recent events into context. Comrade Andrew Flood here managed to book himself a holiday to Istanbul without realizing that it was going to coincide quite nicely with all this stuff kicking off. And so he's going to show you his holiday snaps and fill you in on a little bit of his experiences and so on. And I'm sure he'll also be giving himself a better introduction than I can imagine. But thank you for your patience, and then I'm going to hand it over to the man with the holiday snaps.
Okay. So I was wondering how to explain that all right. I ended up in Istanbul, actually, strangely enough, from being part of a very small reading group with Paul on the development of the absolutist state. And we were reading a couple of really long books, and one of them had a kind of really throwaway reference to the Ottoman Empire at the end of it, where it said, well, it's not really relevant because it's not really part of Europe, and blah, blah, blah. And I was kind of going, there must be a better history available than that. So I started reading stuff, and that got me interested in the whole history. And I was going, I must go to Istanbul sometime. I'd like to look at some of this stuff. And as it happened, I booked a flight over, and I'd seen there was some protest going on in the park about some trees being cut down. But thought, well, I'm just going to have a look at that when I'm there. And then booked the flight. Next day I was booking the hotel, and the cops went in and did that massive tear gas attack on 151 people. Everything started exploding on Twitter and Facebook, and I was like, oh, okay, that's going to change my holiday a bit. So I'm saying all that to make it clear I'm not setting myself up as any sort of expert on Turkey in general. I obviously then started reading a lot. I'm mostly going to be talking about my experiences. And I started with the photo of the Blue Mosque, because actually the first thing I did when I found my hotel in Istanbul, which was 1 o'clock in the morning, is I walked up the road, took that photo and posted it to my Facebook feed so people would know it arrived. So my first morning, I was kind of wandering around essentially the tourist area of the city, the Golden Horn, and Taksim is, by the way, I'm going to mispronounce all the names here, so sorry anybody in the audience who's actually Turkish, so this may be pretty bad at times, but I'll do my best. Taksim is on the other side of the Golden Horn, and it's on top of a hill. And so I'm kind of wandering around looking at things, and I notice all this black smoke is starting to come up. And it's kind of interesting in that all the tourists were completely oblivious to it, but the guys whose job is touting ferry cruisers on the quays had obviously all noticed it and kept turning around and looking up as more and more smoke was coming up. And that's because the cops at that stage were doing one of the many attempted evictions of the park. So I thought that evening I'd go over and have a look for myself. And I was a bit nervous about it. I was travelling on my own, so I thought, well, I won't go all the way over, I'll just go most of the way. And so I went most of the way, and then I went, there's nothing happening, I'll go a bit further. And then I sort of got to the, I took the tram, for those who are familiar with it, the city, and there's a really steep hill that runs up from the last tram stop, so I thought, actually, I'll go a bit up the hill and see what's happening. And of course, eventually I end up in the square itself. Just as it happens when a large demonstration is arriving. And this is the, I wandered around and snapped a few photos. Now this photo is kind of interesting. There's two reasons why it's interesting. One is this little group in the center taking a picture of themselves with an iPad, which I saw quite a lot of. It was actually interesting how many smartphones and iPads were around. And the other reason it's interesting is that apart from the fact that some people are wearing hard helmets and have dust protectors on or goggles on, it's a pretty kind of quiet scene. You can't really see any cops. You know, people holding hands there in the foreground, people chatting around the place. So it all looked kind of fairly quiet, and 10 seconds later, this happened. I spoke myself earlier, I think I'm this figure here, I'm not quite sure. But, yeah, so basically I hadn't even seen a cop at this stage. When I zoomed in on one of those photos, I realised actually there was a water cannon in the distance that I hadn't noticed. And this one's kind of useful because it gives you an idea of how tear gas has actually been used in Turkey, which is, I've experienced it before in Prague, for instance, and generally the way it gets used is the cops fire it into, you know, the front line of whoever's causing a bit of trouble, so they go back a little bit, and, you know, that's the way it works. But not, it turns out, in Taksim. Instead, what they did was they decided to drop it pretty much simultaneously on top of the back, the whole square, and the square's really big. So that if you were caught randomly, as I was, taking a picture of those tourists, I've actually just spotted that might be them there. But, you know, you found yourself in a position where suddenly you're trying to move with probably 1,000 or 2,000 other people through a couple of 100 meters of gas before you can get to anywhere else. The intention of that sort of use of gas is, I think, clearly to intimidate people from going to protests, you know, because the lesson you're essentially getting is, doesn't matter if there's nobody causing any trouble, in inverted commas, doesn't matter if you stay well back from whatever is going on, what we're just going to do is gas everything in sight, and you're going to get caught in that. So really, if you're smart, you're going to stay at home and not turn up. So the next day I went up to have another look. Now, it's useful to know a little bit about the geography, because that's kind of one of the things that's harder to pick up, and I'm going to make some crude comparisons with Dublin, which probably have a certain validity. So, the square itself is really big. It's about, I'd say, 3 times the size of Stephen's Green, maybe 4 times the size of Stephen's Green, and the park is about 20% of that. It's also a fairly major transport hub. There's the metro goes through there, a lot of buses pick people up from there, and it's quite central. And what's kind of the equivalent of Grafton Street, except it's much longer, runs up to it at one end. So when you look back at this tear gas picture, you can sort of imagine it's a bit like the cops going crazy and tear gassing Stephen's Green one afternoon, right? If you think about it in those terms. This isn't something that's happening in some isolated part of the city. It's a place people are moving through every day. The morning I arrived, in fact, I was quite impressed with this, because I went fairly early and the city workers were already out spray painting the graffiti off from the night before. And that's quite interesting because there's this kind of attempt going on to make things look like they're normal and that there's nothing much happening. And like one of the crazy things was after they retook the park, about a week later, they sent in city workers to plant some new saplings and some flowers, even though nobody was actually allowed in the place, you know, so you have the kind of, who's sitting in an office thinking this actually looks good, you know, what exactly, how is that actually happening? But it's a routine that kind of fails when you go up this long street, you enter the square just after this point, and the first thing you come across is some of these things, which are the tomas, which are, what they call public order suppression vehicles or something like that. So basically the water cannon tanks, people sometimes call them panzers. Turkey has a lot of these, a couple of hundred I understand actually, which is kind of also tells you something interesting. And as well as high pressure water, which is actually pretty dangerous if anybody's ever been hit by one of those things on full blast, they knock people off their feet, you typically go over backwards, you land on your head and kill you because of that. They also have the habit of actually trying to run people over them. People have seen video footage of that. There's another one that kind of gives you more of an idea of the mass of it. And it's all kind of about routine police violence, you know, quite a high level of routine police violence. You also, tear gas canisters, they're meant to be fired up in the air, but a fairly standard use is actually to fire them horizontally, so if you're nearby and you get hit in the head, you can get pretty seriously injured. About a dozen people have lost their eyes due to that actually happening. The other thing you get is plainclothes police, or secret police, not quite sure the right technical term for them, is snatch squads operating out of side streets and grabbing people who get isolated. And all that sort of thing builds up, sort of general impression where you're going, oh, I'm really not sure I want to go to that place because it actually sounds quite, that sounds quite dangerous. There's all these different things happening. And I think that's useful to keep in mind when you see the size of the mobilizations and the fact that people can keep going back and have kept going back. This is the top of that street, I quite liked it, because basically I presume the guys who would normally be selling, tourist maps or water or tobacco or whatever else, had mostly switched to selling construction hats, that's for those horizontally fired tear gas canisters, dust masks against tear gas, and you can also see some swimming goggles in here. So as well as seeing all the water cannon when you entered the square, the other thing you saw was all these stores where people were selling this sort of stuff. And these banners were kind of hanging around the park at a number of different points. It's interesting that they're in both Turkish and English. And you see a lot of this where several languages have been used, and that's with a view to knowing people are watching things internationally. So the park itself, as I said, it's about 20% of the area of the square. And I went looking for a map online, this was the best I could find. It's obviously an old map. Because it was under development at the time, and that's what a lot of this is about, most of the buildings are either knocked down or derelict. But the square is here, and the pictures you've seen of kind of piles of burnt out cars as a barricade are mostly along this side of it. This side is quite a long way above street level, and so is this. You've got your kind of, there's a stage down here, so this bit's been used for assemblies. It's kind of all the different left groups have kind of stalls set up for this front bit. People were camping on every available space throughout the rest of it. And then there was a kind of medical tent and a kitchen tent down the back end of here, and also a radio tent. So that's just to give some idea of the actual space itself. So the barricades, as I said, they're the kind of things everybody is familiar with. In both terms of both mainstream and alternative media, the focus has tended to be on spectacular images, they make good photographs. So we see tear gas clouds like I've used already, water cannon, the barricades, and at the moment the whole standing man reading phenomenon, like anything that makes a kind of iconic image. When I was heading over, I had a Turkish friend who'd actually gone back to Istanbul to follow all this, who I first met at the Zapatista Encuentros back in the 1990s, when we travelled in Mexico together. But she DM'd me on Twitter to say that, not to pay too much attention to the square, because the thing that was actually important was the processes that were happening in the park, and that was the sort of interesting thing to look at. So the park's surrounded by barricades. I've got a couple of pictures, that's obviously at night. This one I liked because whoever it is with the dreadlocks had come up the street, got as far as the barricade, and was probably contemplating whether or not they could do a Steve McQueen from The Great Escape. over it. They looked at it for a while and decided they couldn't. Again, that's the front looking out into the square. And you can imagine being in a barricaded park like this that's surrounded by water cannon, hundreds of rifles, sort of seem to be very keen on firing off tear gas, would be make things a little tense. So one of the things you saw when you went in was people had used humor in different ways to try and diffuse that tension. There were a lot of banners, these were all in Turkish, saying things like, far more gas, we're addicted to it now, you can step in the first round, and things like that. But the things that amused me most were the kind of take your photo in a kind of fake seaside action scene type thing. There were two of these, that's the first one. And this one was particularly good for these fake facial expression. So that's one way of dealing with the tension. But I mean, that's funny, but it's important to underline that, of course, there were, of course, black people were, have been killed around these protests. This is a memorial inside the park to one of those people. It's actually right beside the first of those photo banners. The other thing, you guess, is basically around the edges of the park, there's people keeping an eye on cops. This is a nice, relaxed-looking picture. I kind of also like the flowers around it. And keeping an eye out for fresh assaults. So, yeah, this idea that the interesting stuff is happening inside, and it's been made much less visible. Being inside actually was quite interesting, because it looked quite like a lot of the Occupy side visited, both the stuff here but also the stuff in London, except it was a lot bigger and there were a lot more people. You had, for instance, multilingual signs reflecting an awareness of being part of an international movement and wanting to communicate with that movement, you know, so signs with lots of languages, so people wandering around or people seeing photographs could not try and understand what was going on. I still don't know how I feel about this, but the anonymous masks, you know, the Sky Fox thing that people are wearing all over the place. You had quite a few people wearing those. You also had strange anonymous banners, which this one has Hitler on it. I think it's probably a negative reference. And you also had lots and lots of kind of hand-painted signs with various slogans. And I think some of these are the ones about far more tear gas, we love the stuff. And of course you had the library, which you have in pretty much every Occupy anywhere, even if sometimes it just consists of four or five books. This one was still going pretty well after the cops had trashed it at least once, and I think possibly twice at this stage. And you had little groups of people chatting to each other, talking, or playing music. Thankfully, I didn't come across any drum circles, although I was told one briefly existed.
Not in
And you had various art things happening around the place as well. This was a tree of dreams, I think, and the idea was you write down a piece of paper what you wished for and you'd stick it up, and lots of people had done that and put bits up. The interesting thing is, when the cops recaptured the park the following night, I think it was, there's a photograph of them actually setting fire to this. So that's quite a powerful sort of image if you know what it is that they're actually burning. Towards the front of the park, you also had stands from various left groups and others, revolutionary anarchists. Back inside a bit, there's a feminist stand, but you also had ones from the traditional left, from the Kurdish left, from Kemalist Turkish nationalists, from LGBT groups, and from environmental groups. And something everybody who was Turkish that I talked commented on was how strange it was that all these people were in the same space together. You also had, of course, the football fan thing, lots of people have been talking about that, which may want to say something critical about it. Football shots were quite common, and as I said, like with the nationalists, there were certainly contradictions here. The only real conflict I saw internally was between the kind of Turkish nationalists and the Kurdish left, and would almost always happen when somebody would start singing a song, and somebody else would start objecting to whatever that song was about. But most importantly, this is part two of the football stuff. Politicians made us enemies, nations are brothers. So again, quite a lot of signs that are actually in English. But the most important aspect was the process of assemblies that were going on. There were meetings going on constantly. Some of them were small, some of them were big. For some of the big decisions, it broke down into different sections. During the day when I was there, it was mostly young people. My Turkish friend told me that it was very often people skipping class who were in college. And then in the evening after work, it became much older, as basically people were coming in after work. So that's the evening. So this one, there's a couple of things I wanted to talk about. I'm not going to talk about the specifics of the political situation in Turkey. I'm going to mostly leave that up to Sevinc because I'm a complete amateur on it. I've just been doing research recently, but there are a couple of interesting things. The day before I left, the Prime Minister Erdogan had his big rally in Istanbul, in one of the suburbs. He claimed 1 million people turned up, but at least 300,000 people turned up, so it's very big. They laid on free buses and things. And his speech, which went on for 2 hours, was actually really interesting because it was this kind of somewhat paranoid populist conservative attack on the people in Gezi Park that was designed, you could say, to appeal perhaps to people who were rural and to people who were older. So it was all about them protesters being foreign agents. He claimed people had had a three-day drinking party in a mosque, and he claimed that any women who went into the square wearing headscarves were being attacked. So actually, I was just going through my photos, and I noticed this one. I was actually at the time taking a picture of the guys with the camera, but it didn't seem nobody's particularly interested in the woman walking through in the background at all. My other reason, though, for using this one is, I think an issue coming from Western Europe when we're looking at events in Turkey is falling into a kind of Orientalist perspective on it, you know, where Turkey is the southern man of Europe, it, you know, it's prone to despotic leaders, the people are prone to being religious, and all of this is something that happens over there and doesn't have that much to do with us. And I was thinking of a good way to illustrate that, and thankfully the Irish police actually gave me a hand today. So this picture was taken Tuesday at the Rossport Solidarity Camp down in Mayo. I was down there over last weekend, but I left at this stage, and obviously somebody decided it would be a good idea to do a solidarity banner, take a picture, put it on Facebook so people in Istanbul, or Turkey and Brazil could see it. But if you think about the thing that started up the Gezi Park protest, which was a relatively small environmental protest that was about this bit of development, you know, a lot of this is about development, developing infrastructure, developing the country, small group of protesters trying to stand in the way of this development, cops went in, you know, tear gassed them, the media refused to cover it, people got all up in an outrage about it, and cops kept attacking people, and you go, well, that couldn't happen here, could it? But for anyone who doesn't know, there were five people arrested down in Eris today, and you won't find any mention of that in any of the media. You won't find any mention of the protests that have been going on there all week. So it appears these things can happen all over the place. So I'm going to take a break here and let Sevinc talk for a while.
Most of the news, I don't have one tenth of the news. He has, because I haven't been to Istanbul since March, that's when I came back. I was gonna start my speech, then I saw Comrade Kostas from Greece, specially welcome him because at the time when Greek uprising started, we hadn't a clue what he was going through. Now I do. So thanks for coming, Kostas. Right. So, if I claim to know any more than most of you, I'd be lying, to be honest. I'm following from semi-reliable and some reliable sources of information, the usual ones, the unusual ones would be through emails and phone calls and all that. So, instead of like lecturing you on Turkish politics and history and all that, I made a list of issues I'm going to mention if time allows, but make a few clarifications in between there as well. Practicalities mostly to do this groundwork of connecting and solidarizing, says one of our comrades, for our solidarizing. I've been calling all interested parties, whoever they are, to get used to using the term people from Turkey or people of Turkey. That's even not suitable at the moment. Because it's not only Turkish people in the ground, actually a huge and strong presence of Kurdish activists from the start with their powerful presence and resilience and bravery was one of the very important driving forces of the resistance, becoming a resistance, so it's important to note that. And they were doing this at the expense of the peace process, because that was the stick the state government was using against the Kurdish political party. If they took part in the resistance, they were jeopardizing the peace process. So that was the kind of double whammy and blackmail they had to put on with. the resistance itself wouldn't have taken this turn in many ways in certain areas and cities, for example, in Gazi district, without the experience and resilience of the Kurdish activists and Kurdish anarchists in particular. But why do we not hear about it? This complex situation there, but I believe it's lack of self-promotion with the good thing on that. Turkish anarchist magazine Meydan released at the last edition, right before the resistance kicked off. And just to give you an idea of what was big in the radical milieu right before that, one of the big news pieces in the magazine is the establishment of the Association of Conscientious Objectors. They're not a bunch of people, I can guarantee you. It's an anti-militarist activist organization whose members and rejectionists who support them have endured lengthy sentences, torture, and death for refusing to serve in the army. This park has close historical connections also to the history of LGBT movement in Istanbul. They've been in the front line, militant, organized, experienced, and powerful from day first. We're reclaiming our meeting spaces, basically, as LGBT movement. We held out a strong trans march last Saturday, and this Saturday Istanbul Pride, hopefully, will go down the history as the most militant Pride march, maybe, whether we record and acknowledge it or not, that's what we hope. I've seen many immigrants in the images and communicated with many of them during this period, immigrants in Turkey. Not Turkish immigrants abroad, that's part of it too. They're strong resistance background, most of them, and they aspire to support a good cause in terms of democracy and so on. So most of them have done it before. They have experience and presence in their resistance as well. What I've not seen much in the report is the women's struggle in, general reporting percentage-wise, is the women's struggle, participation of Kurdish feminists, radical feminist groups, mothers of the missing, mothers of the prisoners, mothers of veterans, have all been overlooked. These are strongly organized women organizations. Mothers all poured out 2 weeks ago, it was two weeks ago on the weekend, when Prime Minister called on the families to come and fetch their children that very night, otherwise they'll all be treated as terrorists. So mothers came out. Mehmet Uluda, my Socialist Worker Party friend from Turkey, actually explained it in more detail at his meeting last week. And we saw the images, mothers coming up to Gezi Park, fencing the park area and protesters hand in hand so they wouldn't be hurt during the attack. So that's the kind of reaction you're getting from women as well. So they poured out and fenced the youth and protesters and whole lot. And the recent backlash of the religious government in place, AKP, the Prime Minister's party, they're coming at people with a ban on abortion rights. We have been enjoying abortion and freedom to choose for abortion for, say, about 45 years in Turkey, and it hadn't been difficult before then either, but they're coming at people with this ban now. Bullying ordinary people and young families with crushing PR campaigns into having three children. At least he has this demographics obsession. Countless women murders, it's a legal, social, and political phenomenon. Domestic violence, honor killings, girl brides, leniency of rape sentences, if any, child abuse, all had triggered this grassroots momentum in the women's movement. Traditionally, most women movement organizes from top down, from academia, from middle class, from liberal classes, and so on. There's something else different going on in that scene in Turkey and in Kurdistan at the moment. Kurdish women in BDP, the Kurdish party ruled towns in the Kurdish area, are highly organized, have been organized a lot longer than the so-called radical feminist movement in Turkey. And They are also well aware of the centers of command where this brutal oppression is coming from. I'm quoting this sentence from a comrade of ours, Ana Mendes, who was here last month in May for a public lecture. So I'd like to go back to her with this discussion. Do people know the centers of command when the oppression is coming directly? This government closed down women's shelters. Their local councillors went after these women and family shelters. They went after artifacts, theatres, statues, paintings, young couples snuggling, women's red lipsticks, people's alcohol consumption habits without any treatment facilities. They went after gold, copper, and many other precious mines. They went after tea gardens, old cafes, old bazaars, and turned all of them into shopping malls one by one. And this is a traditional religious right-wing party, so-called conservative traditionals. I've also been calling our supporters in the radical milieu to try to decouple our desire for a new way of life, new way of decision-making, and resisting from the nationalist flag fetishism going on the ground. So there's, like Andrew mentioned, the centrist nationalist chemist groups are there who are normally hostile to Kurdish uprising, and they're a hostile party to the peace process going on at the moment. So these need to be paid attention to as well. And they're also, it's important to note that though I welcome the presence of any groups in the resistance against the establishment, it's also important to note at times during the resistance, it's still going on, certain sections of the centrist groups are calling the army on to duty, but this fucking army isn't coming out. They've been calling and calling for 6 weeks now. Army isn't to come out this time. I think they lost a lot of power. 2nd of July this year will be the 20th anniversary of Sivas massacre, central eastern town in Turkey. 33 lives were taken away in a hotel in that province at an arson attack by an angry mob of religious fanatics in 1993. Courts passed the statute of limitation for time, so basically they say it's too late. None of the attackers have been prosecuted. About 5 of them are missing, and 6 of the lawyers who were defending the suspects are all ministers or MPs in the ruling party. So that's important to note as well. Trauma that caused by this event and other previous sectarian attacks on Alawite community previously is one of the ingredients of this resistance in Turkey at the moment. So I wanted to refer to Third Policeman. Anybody read the Third Policeman? I passed that joke, that not enough. So this whole thing sometimes reminds me of that scene where the constable asks the citizen if it's about the bicycle. If it's not, he's not interested in any other topic because he's a bicycle himself, actually. So, this thing comes out a lot about the trees and the park. Is it about the trees? I said it before, I hope it is. I hope it is about trees. Hope it is about trees, the world we live in today, the environment, about the people who had started green resistance years before this, without naming it with any ideology, who have been resisting to keep the forests, the rivers, the grazing lands, who fight for the common land space and forest and mountain and river that were once common. I hope it is about that and about the fruit growers and hazelnut growers who can't afford to buy their own produce anymore, who are thrown out of bankruptcy courts, out of their land and homes. I hope it's about those people. Resistance supporting at international level doesn't mention the Kurdish and Turkmen agricultural workers who collect the best of your oranges, figs in your Jaffa cakes, and your tea leaves, and who live in plastic tents in 40 degrees in places
with no running water. I hope the resistance will come to those people as well. Last Monday, resistance established its political party. I've mixed thoughts about it, so I'm not going to go into translating their constitution. We have learned better that most of these aspirations in establishing parties like this are ideas from books which were read 30, 40 years ago. This resistance, I think, knows better. It's articulating ideas that are homemade and now. They will judge every party, every individual, including ourselves, the radicals, the friends, the supporters, everybody with suspicion and long observation. This is not going to be a velvet revolution, in my opinion. AKP, the party, is ready to use further violence. It'll probably be long before we can overthrow this government, and that is going to be the only the first step of it. So this is not really the Hunger Games, the movie, you know. It's going to be tough going. Resistance in and around Gezi Park does look like it's about this alcohol and party, the upper middle class enjoying their lives, and they want that freedom and consume alcohol and so on. But the media I followed, most of us followed in this room, had strong signs of the impact of the disproportionate use of intelligence, creativity and sharp wit, and that this is used against the disproportionate use of force and violence of the police. State security apparatus has clear signs of religious fascism, in my opinion, which is all too familiar here from the recent history of this country. I was told that the first social party meeting I attended 18 years ago back in Cork, that fascism doesn't always wear Doc Martens or shaves its head or bomber jackets, the 80s image of a Nazi. This one, who's ruling us in Turkey, is dressing from very expensive brands. Prime Minister Erdogan was known for this bravery, and he expressed at a Davos meeting with the Israeli Prime Minister, he said, "One minute you're killing people," this and that became the hero in the Middle East 3 years ago. I was reading Jerusalem Post last night, because they have a piece about them every night. The US prepares to arm Syrian rebels within a month. So this made me very suspicious about what's going on in Turkey. Because this time, this prime minister can't say 1 minute to this. 1 minute, why are we arming people against each other? And it can't say 1 minute to Israel, who was bombing the Gaza for a whole weekend the last week. So conviction doesn't really come to picture in any of the Muslim states when it comes to Palestine, really. I mean, the political conviction. So it's like all in the game for they support Hamas and they support Muslim brothers and they run the show, and it's all in the game. There are ministers and politicians ruling countries, making decisions on our lives in the Middle East, who are not able to go to toilet without the permission of the CIA and its chief of operations of the Middle Eastern operations. They have a plan for Middle East, and they put that plan into operation to break those societies and turn them against each other to make their military business bigger and bigger, to get more profits from the sales of arms. So we need to remember the global big picture in this as well. Two of the most popular awe-inducing groups are the anti-capitalist Muslims for me in the resistance, who've not given up on their call for peaceful coexistence and ecological spirituality. The other are the football fans, which I'm still not able to trust yet, we see. My favorite line says, "Brutal state is same stick, different hand. My favorite time is today and now." And I promise I'm not going to have answers to many of your comments and questions. Also because this meeting is also an invitation to seek those answers together, where this resistance is going to go. Thank you for your time.
move to the question and answer session. I'm just going to hand over to Andrew for another few minutes because he wanted to make a point about the evil darkness that is Twitter, apparently, according to Erdogan, or the role of social media, which has been seen in many different ways. So, over to you, Andrew.
So anybody who reads stuff I write will know I'm a bit obsessed with social media and the way it's changing both the world and what it means to be a revolutionary in the world. And I think what's happening in Turkey is part of a process that we've seen running over since 2010, really, where this is becoming something that's increasingly visible. I mean, basically, as soon as you walk into Gezi Park, you see things with hashtags stuck to them all over the place. You know, it's almost become like a political badge in itself. You put a hashtag on something to show it's something political you're talking about, even though it's a banner, and you can't tweet a banner, even tweet a photo of a banner, though, and stuff also being in English. Showing you that picture of the four tourists taking themselves with an iPad, a picture of themselves with an iPad earlier. But this was also really common. You'd walk around and see people taking pictures of themselves with a mobile phone, a barricade in the background, or getting your mate to take a picture. And probably in most of the cases, these are then being shared on Facebook or whatever. And so it's quite a significant thing, because if you look at Tunisia and Egypt, one of the things that actually turned that from being a small movement of a handful of people in the square to something that involved lots of people was the decision of lots of individual people to make these sort of public identifications. And because there is a risk associated with it, obviously, and it was the defiance of that risk that was part of the process of turning very small movements into very big ones. And I think the initial process in Gezi Park is very obviously part of that. Initial demonstrations were small, 150 odd people. You know, what made it big was the repression of that protest. The other thing it's relevant for is in terms of the huge hold the mainstream media has had up to now in terms of people's understanding of the world around them. I like this because it's combining so many different things in a single image. For people who don't know, the penguin is because when initial large-scale repression was going on and Turkish television wasn't covering it, they were broadcasting cookery programs on one channel and a documentary about penguins on the other. So penguins basically then started to appear on absolutely everything. You didn't need to explain it, you just put a picture of a penguin on it. People knew this was a reference to the media being so stupid. The other thing I have a photo of the banner itself in the park, but there's a famous piece by, I think, Banksy, which is, you know, kind of your traditional masked writer lobbing a bunch of flowers. So some of you decided it would probably be good to rework this as the penguin. It was actually stuck up on one of the shop fronts on the main shopping street, and of course it's got your inevitable hashtag stuck to it as well. So it's bringing lots of things together. And the interesting thing is everybody knows this is a significant influence. I mean, Erdogan's crazy speech had several references to the evil that is Twitter, you know, like really strange stuff to be actually reading it. And by everybody, I'm including the cops. This is a picture I took with the long lens on a kind of quiet afternoon in the square when I was just watching what the cops were doing. And the interesting thing is this guy here who's got his smartphone out and presumably he's having a look at Twitter or whatever to find out what's really going on. Nobody's particularly inclined to believe the mainstream media version. The other thing that was quite common in the park were posters advertising the various sort of activist media type projects. And I mean, I know people in Dublin, in fact, there's a story worth telling in itself. My phone didn't have a data roaming plan, so that meant I couldn't actually check on what was happening when I was wandering around the streets, only back in my hotel. So if I was heading over to Gezi Park and it was looking a little bit tense, I had an arrangement with Aileen, who's sitting over there, where she'd follow stuff online, and if things started to look really hairy, she'd text me so I'd have some sort of idea about what was going on. I also actually had the realization that if things were being a little bit crazy, I was actually probably a lot more useful being back in the hotel, being able to interpret what was coming in and reposting it out to other people than I was wandering around as a lone individual on the streets getting in everybody's way. So I think that's one of the interesting kind of long-running things, is this new force that's come into our lives and the way we as revolutionaries are interacting with that and the way it's transforming the left, because a lot of the old left are having enormous problems dealing with this. I mean, a lot of them, the initial reaction was people can't use their stuff, you know, you're not allowed to set up email lists, like do that sort of stuff. And at the moment, a lot of it is about trying to recreate the old party form of the left and the old left newspaper and all that in an online form, something that mostly hasn't really worked and hasn't really engaged people. So, not specific at all to Turkey, but one of the things I found really interesting was the examples of this that were very visible in terms of what's happening there.
That's exactly why I'm not saying this.
Okay, so I now take questions from the floor. And can I see a few hands and then. I'll remember those.
Yeah, I'd just be interested in, from either, well, maybe Sevinc or Andrew as well, on comments on how the initial protests in Gezi Park spread over the rest of Turkey, and like how did that process happen, and was it just tapping into something that's been simmering away?
Okay, I'll take the couple questions and then
I don't know if this is a question or a comment, but both speakers, and thanks very much for everything that you said, mentioned nationalists. Now, I would think that a nationalist is properly defined as someone who is a patriot of the nation, and someone who loves trees as much, incidentally, as anyone who is not a nationalist, non-nationalist is. Something like this requires that the nationalists be on board. If a bad regime is to be overthrown, it is the core nationalists who are patriots of them. And to be a nationalist, and to be a Turkish nationalist, doesn't mean you hate Kurds necessarily. Well, you could love Kurds and still be a patriotic nationalist Turk. Why not? My question is, why not open maximum dialogue with nationalists who are opposed to the regime?
Okay, young man in the structure.
2011 was considered around the world a kind of a year of revolution, where people comparing it to 1968 and 1848, and everything was seen to be up in the air, and there was a different kind of revolutionary uprising connected by technology, social media, and so on. And things kind of died down after the 2011, Occupy was clear, we had the Arab Spring that dried up some 2012, it's quite quiet here, and things seem to be heating up again now, more things like in Brazil and in Turkey, and just to throw it open, just for an opinion, where do you think this ends? Where are some places in the world where it does have potential to spill over, so to speak?
I just want to say in response that I think almost anywhere you can't predict, but I think large parts of the world are threatened to overlap. I wanted, if I may, to argue about one bit of the presentation that we heard, and that is the idea that the existing Turkish government, the Erdogan government, is fascist. Now, you come to a meeting where people who are smashing people on the streets, brutal repression, somebody says they're not fascist, it sounds like you support them or apologize for them. I assure you that's not the case. I'm arguing from a standpoint of total solidarity with the protesters. But I think the term is an important one and we shouldn't misuse it. And I think it's a misuse of the term, I can explain. First of all, I think that in all fascist countries, the police and the state apparatus are repressive, they are a weapon of the ruling class, and they will, in many different circumstances, suppress people on the streets. That doesn't make it fascist. So the Irish guards would do it, the American police would do it, the French police would do it, the British police would do it, and so on. These are not fascist countries. That's the first thing I would say. Fascism is qualitatively different level of repression and a qualitatively different kind of political movement. Right? There's not really a comparison between the Erdogan government or the party it is and either Hitler or Mussolini or Franco or classical fascism or the British National Party or Golden Dawn in Greece and so on. this is not because I think being a fascist is about having a silly moustache or wearing a swastika or a bomber jacket. This is not that image. This is about the fundamental nature of what fascism is as a political organization and state, which crushes any kind of opposition, doesn't allow any kind of opposition parties or trade unions or whatever, and arises in specific circumstances. And I think it's a mistake to call. I know I'm going to speak a little bit, but I'm making an argument which people will go home. I think it's a mistake to call this government fascist because it dovetails with a right wing and conservative argument that sees all Muslim movements as fascist. So it says Morsi is fascist in Egypt, which means things got worse in Egypt. You know, and that the revolution was absolutely terrific. And then becomes an excuse even for intervention and so on. Every movement which has a Muslim character becomes then fascist. And that is, in that sense, seen as worse than liberal democracy in Europe. So I think it's a wrong term to use, and we should denounce them for being a repressive neoliberal government and a repressive neoliberal party, etc., etc., not as fascists. That's my opinion. It's strategically unhelpful. And real fascism in Turkey or in Greece, where it's Golden Dawn, or in France if the Front National came to power, or in Hungary if the Jobbik Party came to power, or in Britain if the British National Party, the EDL, came to power, would be qualitatively different in the level of reaction and repression in my opinion.
Okay, thank you. All right, so if I can ask some speakers to come back on points. Oh, yes. Also, Aileen's been handing out some feedback forms while we've been talking. I'll take you down to speak. So if you could, we'd very much like if you could fill these in, because it helps us to, you know, to improve our process. That sounds like I'm doing some kind of business seminar here, but it really does help actually get feedback, so thanks for that. I'm going to get the speakers to come back, so we've had four questions there now, and then I'll take more speakers. I've got a few down there.
Andrew, how do you want to
do? Don't
look
me. Well, I would like to respond on my own behalf to the last, I'm going to start from the last speaker. I'm a bit old, to be honest, to hear it from my field, from comrades in a wider milieu of activism and is RKP fascist. I don't debate about it anymore, I'll be honest with you. Because you claim to, your claim is that describing RKP as fascist is qualitatively, it's a mistake basically, you write it out as a mistake. I invite you to my experience, sir. As a Turkish woman who's liberal, who has no God, okay? Who's feminist, radical, from the country, and Alawite, from a minority. I invite you to be in my shoes, then say what's fascist and what's not. I am sick and tired of hearing this stupid argument from all over the left, right, and center, lecturing us Muslim women as to what our problems are and what are. I'm not here to potty train anybody on fascism. We live it. You like it or not, it's fascism what we experience. And it's not new, and it's not today. It does, with your description, sir, it does not allow for any opposition. It oppresses women in a particular fashion with a planned machinery. So I invite you to live in that oppression, then come and describe what fascism is. I'm nearly 50, I haven't seen freedom. It's either the army's boots, it's imam's boots, the government's boots, the police boot is kicking me. And it is kicking, sir.
sir. It is kicking. Just because they can't put us in that big gas chambers and do us all in thousands, in your opinion, it doesn't fit the bill. I'm sorry. I'm not going to have this argument in this room if it continues.
The other three questions, then.
Could I ask the other speaker what he thinks on my question?
Well, okay, I'll give you an honest answer. I think you've come from another organisation, you've come looking for a point you can make, a point of political difference to explain why your line is better than her line. You've seized on Sevinc's use of the word fascism as your opportunity to do that, and you've delivered a long technical lecture on why her use of the word fascism is incorrect. I think it was quite patronising. I think my sympathies would actually be very much with what she's just said. I think technically, yeah, you're probably right. You know, technically you're probably right. It's not part of the classic fascist movement. You've proved your point. Mission accomplished. Well done. I'm not sure it's a useful mission, and I don't particularly like the pattern of the traditional left of using these issues to lay out its own geopolitical stance and do its chest beating. I don't think it's useful. You asked me what I thought, that's what I thought. Technically, 4 marks. On the...
There were other questions
that I don't... Yeah.
For the record,
I don't even think it's all that accurate to actually describe him as a dictator. I discussed that in a fairly long piece I wrote, but, like, you know, that's another thing. How did the protest spread? As far as I understand it, it spread through transmission across social media. People seeing images of people being tear gassed, other people coming down, that spreading, that building up. I think the fact that the government repressed very violently a very small protest and then tried to make sure that wasn't covered guaranteed the fact that it actually spread. It gave some things people wanted to tell other people about. On the nationalism question, well, I'm not arguing, you know, that, I mean, it wouldn't make any sense whatsoever for me to argue anyway that, you know, anybody in particular should be excluded from the park. I mean, I don't even speak Turkish, so I couldn't put that argument across. I think, yeah, dialogue with whoever is there is inevitable in that sort of context. But I do think it's useful to be aware of the real problems nationalism brings with it, particularly in the Turkish context, but, you know, also we can talk about it in the Irish context. And also to be very aware that nationalism is one of the populist methods the government is trying to use to defeat the movements. I mean, maybe a third of Erdogan's speech was how this was all an international plot by the BBC, the Germans, me, whoever else he could possibly pull out, Twitter, Facebook, you know, everybody was all plotting against Turkey to bring it down. You know, and appealing basically to that Turkish nationalism. I mean, nationalism to me is a relatively irrational thing. You know, like when I went to Istanbul, when I went to the park, I saw people doing stuff that was quite similar to what I've done here. I've seen people doing in other countries, other comrades have seen people doing elsewhere. I had an identification with what they were doing. I didn't feel that they were Turkish and I was Irish and we didn't have much in common because of that. I felt that we were engaged in a sort of similar global struggle. Now, where national differences fit into all that is an enormously complex question. Well, that would basically be my opinion on it. The third question was where next?
I would like to add something about the mission issue.
Sorry. Can I get you to come in after finishing? I'll put you down to speak.
Okay.
That's all right. Thank you.
The third question, where next? Wow, I wish I could do that. Crystal ball. I think the really interesting thing actually about both Turkey and also what's happening in Brazil is that it wasn't even predictable by people locally on the ground, except in the sense of saying, well, a lot of people are angry about stuff, this is a bit of a powder keg, it might blow up. I mean, what we've seen in several places now, it's what looked like quite small initial issues that developed this momentum of their own. You know, it's not the question that somebody... I had a long conversation on the plane on the way back with a Turkish guy who was actually an ex-scanner worker. It was quite interesting. He'd gone back to Turkey and become a born-again Muslim in his own phrase and was quite suspicious of what the movement was, but was very open to dialogue. honest. And he was quite convinced by this was a German plot to stop the third airport development idea, which was going around. And the obvious response was, well, how the hell would the Germans have managed to work it out that if we get the police to really tear gas the hell out of everybody, then this movement is going to explode from that point? And my point there is that nobody has that crystal ball that they can sit down and go, this is how we make these things happening. I mean, the interesting thing is they are happening, so it's much more a question of when they arise, how we then relate to them, how we work with that.
Okay, I've got a couple more questions, so I'll put your hand up. But, yeah, people haven't spoken before speaking next. So, gentlemen in the box with the beard effect.
Thank you. I thought every conspiracy in the room is done. I come from two different places. One is an organization island, this is the UK, and the other is Turkey. Turkish. I was in Turkey specifically for an island support for 5 days. I think we're on the same time, we're on the same places. Gas and slightly in trouble, but that's normal. So I'd like to address the national question very briefly. If I may use the time limit here, please forgive me for the 30 seconds. So after I use it for 10 minutes. So the rest of the nationalism must be seen in the context that the Irish nationalism, against the British imperialism, time is something very progressive. But at the very same time, the British imperialism and the nationalism in Britain wasn't progressive. So one has to look at nationalism in the context of place, time, and the struggle. So to say Turkish nationalism is also sort of should be worked with, is a very dangerous and dodgy one, because one has to look at the history of the Turkish nationalism, including the military coups, including the sort of sectarianism, including the non-recognition of all smart others, etc. So that's the sort of thing. I'm not going to go much into it, but it is important to understand in that context. So it's not just a formula that fits all situations, right? So I'd like to focus on next steps, really. I think one thing I think in that sense is as we want to sort of struggle in Ireland in terms of the harvesting rights of the forest, I think we are going to talk. So the government that actually called people terrorists, foreign agents, looters, trouble Jews, had to one way or another sort of pull back from it. We don't know whether it's going to hold its promise, etc., but we have won, because it is very important to understand that such a powerful government, having had no challenge for 11, 12 years, had the first of its challenges, and which was a civil disobedience, which was civil protest, which was a broad range of groups coming together in the protest. And actually they lost against 50 terrorists, right? So that's great to notice. I think we should be happy with it, but we should be very careful about it, right? And what's happening now is like in the forums happening all over Turkey, in the evening, local forums, in the under the name of everywhere is Gezi, everywhere is Taksim, therefore everywhere is struggle, is very important, because for the first time, possibly in big cities, the passerby remarks from neighbors saying, good evening, isn't that nice day, isn't that a rainy day, etc., has turned to something different, has turned to debate, and all sorts of things are coming from these forums, including a suggestion for political party, including calling the literature to duty to overthrow, all sorts of things are being debated. But that is a scary thing for every government in the world, isn't it? Neighborhoods are actually coming down and discussing for hours, right? And neighborhoods haven't been always getting along on everything, like the question of Kurdishness, the question of army, etc., right? So I think that's important to understand, and that scared a lot of all governments. I think we're watching this very closely, right? Also, there's a strong demand for the release of prisoners, which is a very tangible demand, which is a very just and understood demand by everyone, and that is, I think, very good, that it's still rising. Next week, on Saturday, this Saturday actually, there'll be another big protest call on Taksim. So Taksim is still a place of protesting, so the government hasn't really won Taksim, you know, in others. Ethan Sousley, I want to honor his name here. This is the guy who was shot and killed in northeastern Turkey, and he was shot and that. He was a terrorist, obviously, which he wasn't, etc. And the demand for this killer police to be brought onto justice is another very tangible demand, and that actually unites people in many ways, because it also appeals to the sense of justice of people. Right? A state cannot, without any sort of consequence, anymore kill its people, because we did have those days where there were no consequences, and everyone is recognizing this. But I'm going to finish up very quickly, right? So, it's certain unknown, because we have nationalists, we have pro-army people, we have revolutionary socialists, we have anarchists, we have independents, we have environmentalists, all in this sort of plan. And I think the streets and the parks of Istanbul and everywhere in Turkey will decide what's going to happen, but they are teaching the government a lesson, and this is the lesson to be defeated. You can be defeated. Now, but that's not a full ultimate defeat of a revolutionary sense, but it's a defeat. It's a defeat for everyone who was the ruler of the whole area in the region, right? And they don't know how this broad movement is going to affect both their vote base, Because of normal order, decent workers, middle class people vote for AKP, right? They don't know how they're going to be affected by that. They also don't know how the movement is going to next, what the movement is going to do next. Are they going to become more nationalist more? Are they going to become revolutionaries? Are they going to become more anarchists? What's going to happen? They don't know. So for the first time ever, the formula doesn't apply anymore, right? Even though we use nationalism as a center, the police beating the people as Turkish flag, everyone takes down the Turkish flag, hang by the protesters, put a bigger Turkish flag, and the protesters have a Turkish flag. So which Turkish flag is going to do what is at the moment uncertain, right? Along the sort of this joke about Pura means and the Kurds are not an assault and an attack, but that's something we can talk today. So they don't know. They don't know what the 50% of the people who say, and that's a big survey, who say they have no political party in future to vote. They don't know what these guys are going to do. And the sort of opposition parties in the parliament, they also don't have a guarantee that these 50% will shift towards their direction. Like, nationalists don't have a guarantee because people say, no, I'm not happy with you, right? So the 80% of people who are not affiliated to any political organization, socialists don't know what to do with them, the anarchists don't know what to do with them, the sort of right-wing parties don't know what to do with them, and that scares the hell out of the political scene in Turkey, which is very important to affiliate and work with these people, understand them, listen to them, right? So, the two things happening in Turkey, I think, and I'll finish with these 2 points, right? One is actually, I suppose, the legacy of nationalism in Turkey, the military nationalism is diminishing, which is important. That's a win for civil society. The second is the status quo, the neoliberal status quo of AKP is rising. What Turkey did is, while one is diminishing, not allowing the other one to rise brutally. That's what I think has been achieved. Now, does it mean it came cheap, it came at no cost? Of course, it did come at a very high cost, but that's the sort of in a civil disobedient way put together the stuff, right? So, look, a lot of cliches have been broken in Turkey. I was happy about it when I came back. The first cliche is the cliche of mothers who pull their children out of the protest, as they were mentioned and as you have seen broadly. The second cliche is we are not that afraid of the Turkish police. Right? The third cliche is the media is a lie, the media, the sort of state media, the sort of capitalist media, lying gates. And guess what? People are questioning, oh, by the way, what might have they lied up on us about the Kurdish struggle over the last 30 years? Right? And of course, the sort of debate of nationalism, debate of state, respect of state, debate of sort of bending backwards, not rightwards, leftwards, to sort of please the state as citizens is diminishing. I think it's very important that people like you, people like me, people like you, the foreign agents, sort of keep going to Turkey, because those bastards are importing German tear gas. That's okay to fire up on their own people, but when a German pianist comes and plays a few tunes in Taksim Square, he becomes a bloody foreign troublemaker, right? And we have to expose AKP, not because it's Islamic or anything like that. And that's conservatism, that's a really important fight. But we have to expose them for what they are. Fighting with the British army shoulder by shoulder in Afghanistan, oppressing a Muslim country, and then saying, Britain is here to destroy Turkey by sending a BBC journalist. For fuck's sake, come tell us about BBC and Syria. We are happy to be all the road on us. So I think they're losing.
Well, in fairness, you did warn me you're going to run over time, buddy.
Sorry.
Not, I think it was
Hello?
A well-received contribution.
Okay. I think he basically told some of the things that I might have told, but nationalism really works in a different context in Turkey. I think it was important to clarify it. Nationalism is kind of an identity problem for Turkish left. That's why it's not like any kind of nationalism, because you always have like the left is always divided in Turkey, and one of the reasons is because there is a leftist. There are some leftist groups that are nationalists that end up being like rightists, and then they can even like branch to be fascists, because the Kurdish groups are one of the most important groups in this movement, and the nationalistic camp is a big liability in the sense that they might actually alienate the most important part of the movement, which is the Kurdish movement. So and one of the good things that has happened is that they have been pacified, they have been won in a way, because they had so much potential for dividing the movement and for, like, it was the biggest liability and biggest risk of the movement. And I think up to now it has been controlled. That in itself is very like impressive. That's an impressive feat. And then when we talk about food, there are two questions basically. Why? How did the people get to this level of mobilization? And the answer to this is difficult and we don't know. But then the other question is, why did Erdogan react so brutally? And if you just see this Gezi, you don't get the whole picture. I haven't been Gezi protests, but I was in Istanbul on the 1st of May. And when we talk about police repression, we have to understand the scale. Because Istanbul is a big city, 12 million people living there. And on the 1st of May, to prevent demonstration of a few thousand people, Erdogan shut down the whole city. I'm talking about shutting down the city. And he was, in his way, quite rational in trying to suppress this protest the way he did, because he managed to suppress all the rallies that were going to occur in Turkey on the 1st of May without any and he didn't have to respond for it in any way. There was some really it's one thing just mobilizing the police and crushing some protesters. It's the other thing, it's something else, having been shut down the whole city. Istanbul is divided by the Bosphorus Strait. So if you just cut, it's easy to cut down the traffic between the movement of people in two parts of the city. And what actually happened on one Sunday was that suddenly all public transport was stopped. You couldn't get a boat from the Asian side to the European side. I was trapped on one side, I couldn't get to the other side. There were no boats, the public transport was shut down, metro was shut down, all the bus system was shut down. It's like this guy can act with impunity, and if he doesn't want a virtually rally occurring, he could just as well shut down the city. And if he wants his supporters to help him out, the metro doesn't work after 12 in the night or 1 in the night. He could as well extend the metro hours for 4 more hours so that his supporters could come to his rally, but then shut down the whole transport system when he doesn't want it. So that's what, and basically it has always been like this. There's a small protest, the formula is just the same. There's a small protest because they're going to build just kind of tumble down an old cinema building, 200 people come to protest, and you just send 2,000 police on top of them, and you just quash them, and that's it, and nothing happens. Then there might be other protests, just for small protests. You just marginalize them and quash them. It's just that this time, it will work, and that in itself is very interesting.
Thank you. Well, I'll give you a right to reply. We have two more pieces. I have marked down, but I'll... Dermo? I've got right down, John.
Just in terms of that, what I think is really interesting looking at this, because I'm writing an article, because I don't know if people are familiar with what happened up in that field in Fermanagh quite recently, and I think it's just interesting in terms of the direction that the movement has gone in, because what was up there was a farce, effectively, in terms of the state now, or the superstructures of the GAs can erect the fence so they can just let people go in and destroy it. And it's like a fucking playground in terms of the way that they can accommodate. And then a lot of the state structure just get a lot of overtime over it because they build up these scaremongering stories and that often happens. And I always remember back to what Subcomandante Marcos said when the uprising happened in Mexico in the Lacandon jungle, and people said, what should we do, what should we do? And he said, don't come here. He said, be as apathetic where you are. And I think that's what we're beginning to see now in terms of the movement. And I think that I was also had the privilege of being able to go to Zuccotti Park and be there in New York when Occupy was going on there. And I think the same thing is happening now in Turkey, because there was civil discussion, big debates are happening, the art of the possible is now being opened up to people. And I don't know what the answers are. And but like what I think is really important is that people are beginning to start questioning these things and beginning to see the power of their own organization. So it doesn't matter whether it's about the trees or whatever it's about, first of all, because that's the spark that starts the fire. And the important thing is it seems like the fire is now starting. And like what I would like us to think about in terms of this group when we walk away from here is we're thinking about in what way can we start those kind of claims and fan those claims here rather than participating in a pantomime in a field in Romana. Maybe, you know, if we can start, like, we already know the state repression is going on right under our noses. It's happened, it's been happening for nearly a decade in the Irish Peninsula around Rossport. But how do we actually spread that out so that actually that level of repression is revealed to everybody and people start participating and saying it's not acceptable? So.
And briefly, John.
Yeah, okay, I'll be very brief. Just first one to say that I didn't come here and make a point of growth. I thought the selling point of the Socialist Workers' Party, of which I'm a member, is that we don't think Erdogan's a fascist, but silly bits to make. I made the point just because simply it's my opinion that it is a mistake, and I think that's a reasonable thing to argue about. Why does it matter? It's not a question of giving an academic lecture on it. Why does it matter? In Germany, before Hitler came to power, the communists, who were the main force on the left, said the existing government was fascist. Right? And they said the Social Democrats were fascist. And that actually was a mistake, because it didn't alert people to the real danger from Hitler. If there are a lot of people who used to go around saying Margaret Thatcher was a fascist when I was in Britain. I used to argue with them. Not because I was a Thatcher supporter, but because the real fascists were the BNP, and it was necessary to understand the difference between them, how you dealt with them from the Conservatives. In Ireland today, you don't have a big fascist movement. Well, that doesn't, thank goodness, but if you get one, you need to understand the difference between them and Enda Kenny and Fianna Fáil as well. And that's, you know, there would be a real difference if you had a major fascist movement between them and Fianna Fáil or Fine Gael. Last point, there is the danger of a real fascist movement in Turkey. There were the Grey Wolves in Turkey who were real fascists. So I just think it's necessary for all our states to use the term advisor. That's just my opinion. I don't think that's wrong or offensive or patronising to anybody to argue it. It doesn't, sorry, negate your experience of repression. I'm not saying you didn't experience repression. I think women experience repression in every society.
And this is one of the forms, do you know? This is another form of women's oppression, what you're doing now.
I don't agree. I think that I'm not... You say it's oppressive to use to put a different point of view. I'm not being rude. I'm just putting a different point of view. If that's oppressive to you, then we can't debate. Then, okay, I'll shut up. Right. Stop.
Okay. Tom?
Yeah, I have a question. I was just wondering, like, what the range between, let's say, the organized labor movements in Turkey to these new forms of protest, like, how did they relate to them at the start, and has that changed in any ways over the like the time that they've been going on?
There are people before me, I think.
Mark, did you put your hand up before?
Yeah, that's right.
No, okay.
I start with you, Tom. To be honest, being away 20 plus years, maybe Mehmet will join in with me to go for a deeper analysis, really. What's the real relationship? What's going on the ground between the labor movement, the unions, and so on, and the resistance itself? In general, again, two major so-called center and center-left, more radical unions, did join in the resistance and did call for general strikes. And maybe first time in, say, 10, 12 years, Kesk was able to bring
the whole entire membership, which is very rare, and it was so-called illegal call of action. So that, I think that's significant. I do have my biased views in, about many of the groups, and nationalists are one of them. By the way, John, I do agree with you. Grey wolves are they the other group that we should be watching, and I would tie it to the nationalists. But as I said earlier, nationalism for me doesn't have an image. It has a result, an impact on me, my life, and lives of people, lives of me. So that's how I look at it. Otherwise, I do agree with you, but I don't agree with you that AKP is not a fascist party and the regime in existence in Turkey is not fascist. So the other thing, I want to go back to the question of the friend in the back earlier. It was how did this spread to Ankara? There is consensus in the room, we don't know. Ankara and eastwards is the expression. But what I know is there's certain amount of isolation of the rural movement and movement in Ankara and Izmir in particular. But Ankara, for example, has been holding out 8 nights now. They're being gassed, beaten, water cannoned. So all the attention is in this cuddly, artistic, full of yoga and full of dancing people. And all good, great creativity. It's impossible a level of creativity, but there is that going on 8 nights now in Ankara. There is that going on in the southern major cities. Izmir, in Izmir, centrist, nationalist, Kemalist groups are holding out, and we do have a dialogue. Somebody mentioned the dialogue. We do have a dialogue, and the evidence of it is the resistance. If there wasn't dialogue, we wouldn't be together on the streets today. But I will keep my head, you know, pinch of salt all the way through, because, to be honest, in the old expression, we will be the first to be hung if this resistance is taken over by the grey wolves or the religious. It will be us again. We will be the victims of it. So I'm not going to butter their bread in any platform. And I will not allow anybody butter AKP's bread in any platform. Whether we can describe them as fascist or not is your technical issue, not mine.
So just some general things. The actual question about the question of the labour movements and its connection with movement in Turkey is interesting, both in terms of the Turkish level, but also I think it's one of the big international questions about the ways of unrest we've seen in recent years. I mean, if you're looking at it from afar, the Turkish situation looks very good because you see these declarations of general strikes. And you'd say, okay, well, that's really impressive. And I remember even when I was there, I was flying out the day there was going to be general strikes, and I was like, oh, God, I'm not going to be able to fly out, I won't be able to get to the airport, I better leave loads of time. But the reality of that is the actual organised labour in Turkey is actually quite weak. It's quite a small percentage of the workforce, and the five unions that joined in the general strike for the 2 days after, or called for general strike 2 days after the repression, are about 2% of the total workforce. So in fact, the reality was I didn't see anything that indicated there was a general strike in the first comes on. I mean, if you think about a general strike in terms of the usage of meaning workers everywhere stop working, which is obviously a very powerful weapon, that wasn't what was happening. Now, I think there's an issue around, like, my opinion, and I've been fairly open about this in the last few years, is I think the kind of organized traditional left has failed in its objective. It's not good for purpose. It's got ways of doing things that are counterproductive. It's got ways of relating to each other that are destructive. And it needs to be reinvented. And what we're seeing at the moment is these new movements coming up with a new way of operating that often exclude the traditional ways the left operates from that, and people shoot them down as soon as they start behaving in particular ways. And to a certain extent, that's good. But I think one of the difficulties that does exist is it's hard to see how a movement that's simply based on, say, neighborhood assemblies can get to the point where it transforms society. Like, it's hard to imagine that without it also going into the workplace. How does that happen? And how does it happen in the context where you have still quite a traditional but not very powerful union movement? So I think, like, that's one of the questions that is obviously there in Turkey, but it's not just there in Turkey, also in Ireland. So I mean, coming out of the Harrington voting room process, which, you know, was a nightmare, I think, for anybody on the organised left here. We're seeing exactly the same sort of questions thrown up here. We're seeing them coming up in the United States around Occupy. We saw them in an almost farcical manner in relation to Occupy in Dublin and the whole debate 2 years ago about the Dublin Council of Trade Union marches. Nobody has yet come up with something that looks any way convincing. And I think being convincing is more than restating a traditional left, oh, we have to turn to the Labour movement type approach to it. That there needs to be a way that we can actually make that real rather than just doing a slogan.
Finally, I'd like to thank you very much for coming.